Good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening, depending on when you're watching that is. I'm so pleased to have a chance to be with you for worship today. It seems like such a long time ago when I last spoke to you. It is a long time ago, I suppose. Everything seems to go in slow motion these days, doesn't it? Unfortunately, I can't take up my post here on a permanent basis just yet, but hopefully it won't be too long before I can. I'm only too happy to give Steve a well-deserved day off in the meantime, though. Our prayer topic for this week is based on Jeremiah 29:11. I alone know the plans I have for you, plans to bring you prosperity and not disaster, plans to bring about the future you hope for. And these are words of comfort for everyone, I suppose, but I think children and young adults are particularly worried about the future just now, with them living in fear and emotional pain. So I'd ask you to please remember them in your prayers this week, as well as those who look after them and care for them, those who try to bring healing, peace, and love to their situations. Now, of course, I'm standing here in a practically empty church centre. There's just myself and Ian here. So you might think that our first hymn for today is maybe a bit of a strange choice. But as you see the words and you listen to the music, and hopefully join in at home, I'd ask you just to picture the day when you're back in here with us. Our first hymn is Let Us Build a House. Of course, we'll be welcome in this place when we have the chance to be together. Let's come to God in prayer now. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you for welcoming us into each new day. Whatever it brings, sun, wind, rain, or snow, it comes from you. Bringing us safely into another day is your gift to us, whatever the day brings. We gather as a worshipping family in praise today, Father. It's a family that's suffering physical estrangement just now. We're separated by distance, but still your Spirit draws us together. And together we praise you that from the very start, your intention was that not only we'd have life, but it'd be a life that's full and free, a life where we have the freedom to make our own choices. And we praise you that in Jesus you showed us just how far you were prepared to go so we could have new life. We praise you that through him you've left us in no doubt as to the length and breadth of your love for us. And we gather to thank you. We thank you that you've brought us to this moment in our lives, individually and in our lives together. We thank you that you gave us eyes to see your creation, ears to hear your word, voices to sing your praise. So much to thank you for the friends and family who sustain us and support us, for the food we have to eat, for the comfort of our homes, for the beauty that surrounds us. So in a silent moment together, we offer our thanks to you for all you do for us and all you provide for us. As well as giving you our praise and our thanks, Father, we also need to ask for your forgiveness. Forgiveness for being the kind of people we are, not the kind of people you want us to be. You give us the freedom to make our own choices, and sometimes we make the wrong ones. We make mistakes. We follow the wrong paths. We're so often not satisfied, so often not happy with what we have. We're sometimes so concerned for our own needs that we don't take enough notice of what those around us need. But we remind ourselves that it's your love that takes the people we are and makes it possible for us to be changed into the people we should be. So open our lives and our hearts again to that love. Forgive us and change us, Father. We ask this in the name of your Son, your greatest gift to us, who taught us this, our prayer to you. Your Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. Let's listen to our next hymn now. This is Mission Praise 315, I Will Tell the Wondrous Story.
Oh,
Now I'd like to give two readings from Scripture today. The first is from the book of Genesis, chapter 50, verses 15 to 21. It's part of the story of Joseph. You could say the wondrous story, to take the words from our last hymn there. And it tells of him being reunited with his brothers, the brothers who had betrayed him. And Joseph, of course, had gone on to be something of a VIP after their betrayal. And his brothers were more than a wee bit nervous about meeting him again. From Genesis 50. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "It may be that Joseph will hate us and pay us back for all the evil that we did to him." So they sent a message to Joseph saying, "Your father gave this command before he died. Say to Joseph, please forgive the transgression of your brothers and their sin because they did evil to you. And now please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. His brothers also came and fell down before him and said, "Behold, we are your servants." But Joseph said to them, "Do not fear, for am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. So do not fear. I will provide for you and your little ones." Thus he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. And turning to the New Testament, our reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 11, verses 30 to 37. It tells of Jesus arriving at the tomb of Lazarus. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this blind man from dying?" Amen. And may God bless our reading of his word today. Now, if I talk about someone getting their just desserts, I'm sure you'll know what I mean. When someone gets their just desserts, it means that they got what they deserved. They got what was coming to them. And while the other desserts that we're all familiar with, the ones that we have after a meal, are good things, sweet things, just desserts usually come after someone has done something that's not so good. You could say that the brothers in our Old Testament passage today were expecting their just desserts from Joseph. They expected to get what was coming to them for all the things they'd done wrong. They'd get what they deserved, that he'd pay them back for all the evil things that they'd done to him. But the desserts that the brothers eventually got were actually more of the good and sweet variety. The sweetest that they could possibly have hoped for. They were given forgiveness. They were given forgiveness and lasting reconciliation with that brother that they'd actually just been downright cruel to. Let's think for a moment about all the evil that Joseph's brothers had done. If you go back in the story to Genesis 18, you'll read that they threw him into a pit, or it might have been a well. They sold him into slavery. They concocted a story to their father Jacob leading him to believe that his favorite son was dead. As evil deeds go, that's pretty extreme. Not so extreme as to stop Joseph from forgiving them. He'd actually done this already in the story if you read it in chapter 45. I'd urge you to read the whole story, by the way. It's full of twists and turns. But as we pick up the narrative now in chapter 50, things are, well, they're a bit different because the father, Jacob, is now dead and the brothers are now frightened. The question is Joseph a man to bear a grudge? The brothers, they're too scared to go to Joseph themselves, so they send a messenger to him. And you could say that they hide behind their dead father, saying, "Your father gave this command before he died to forgive the transgression of your brothers and their sin." Now, we don't know for sure that Jacob did actually give this command, that part of the story, if it happened at all, that is hidden from us. "But forgive the transgression of your brothers," they say. Transgression, meaning offense, crime, breaking the rules. It's a word we see quite a lot in the Old Testament. In Exodus, where Moses speaks of God forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. In the book of Numbers, plenty of times in the book of Job. But it's not a word that we use too often in modern life, though, is it? Or do we? The New Testament equivalent is trespass. And while we don't exactly use it in conversation, not in this sense at least, it features in the Lord's Prayer that's said by millions, "Forgive us our trespasses." Here in Portsoy, of course, the version of the Lord's Prayer we use says, "Forgive us our sins." But it's the same thing. "Forgive us our transgressions. Let us off for breaking the rules. Show mercy." These brothers ask for forgiveness in the same way as we do week after week in the church here and in our prayers at home. They own up to their faults, knowing they'd done wrong, knowing they'd failed to live up to the standards expected of them. So, what does Joseph do? Well, first of all, we find out that Joseph wept. Joseph wept when they spoke to him. And Joseph is a man who's prone to crying, actually. If you count the number of times that Joseph cries in Genesis, you find out that it's more than everyone else in Genesis put together. Yes, men cry. You know, I saw some statistics on that not too long ago, and it said that men cry on average up to 17 times a year. Women, apparently, 64 times. I'll leave it to you to think about how accurate that is or not. But the thing with Joseph's tears, though, is that in every instance, they're always for compassionate reasons, never from self-pity. With all the wrong that's been done to him, you could understand if he shed the occasional tear, feeling sorry for himself. I know that I would if I was stuck in a well, enough to make up my 17 times a year, probably. Yeah, men cry. Even Jesus wept. We were reminded of that just a few minutes ago. So Joseph's tears are compassionate tears. He consoles his brothers. "Do not fear," he says. "Don't be afraid." Now, I've got to admit that I love these words. And I'm going to say that now. I'm going to tell you now that you'll probably hear me repeat these words plenty of times in the coming months, in the coming years. In some form or another, the words come up again and again in the Bible. Isaiah 41, "Do not fear, for I am with you." Mark 6, "Take courage, do not be afraid." Mark 5, "Do not fear, only believe." So if the Bible repeats them constantly, I hope you won't mind when I do too. And of course, when someone tells you not to be afraid, it's because they've got your back, they're looking out for you. They've got to make sure no harm comes to you. When Scripture says, do not fear, we know we're in safe hands. So we've got worried brothers, less worried now, of course, and a reassuring response from Joseph. But when Joseph tells them not to be afraid, he isn't just saying that he's not going to take out revenge on them. What he says is it's not going to be him who gives the brothers their just deserts. Am I in the place of God? He says. God will decide on what happens to them, and he's been in control all along. They've been cruel, they've done awful things, but according to Joseph, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. We can't let this pass without thinking just a wee bit more about it. God meant evil for good. It's a tough one to think about, isn't it? Joseph could have wondered where God was when his brothers were selling him into slavery. Where was God when they told Jacob that Joseph was dead? We could ask now, where's God when natural disasters happen? Where's God when wars kick off? Where's God when a pandemic strikes? Why doesn't he just stop bad things from happening? As one of the Jewish people outside Lazarus's tomb said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying? But where do you stop? Because if we're asking these questions, I think it's only fair that we've got to ask other, more personal questions too. Where is God when we do things we shouldn't? Where is God when we're not honest, when we're jealous, when we're cruel? Why doesn't he stop us? I'm going to let you think about that for just a moment as we listen to our next hymn now. Our next hymn is Beauty for Brokenness.
Oh,
You know, I think the answer to the question, why doesn't God just stop bad things from happening? It's the same answer to the one about why doesn't he stop us from doing bad things. He could. We know he could. He's God. He can do anything. But the rules that God has are the same for everyone. So if we want him to stop wars or pandemics, what we have to ask ourselves is if we're ready for him stepping in to stop us every single time we're about to do something wrong, to make the wrong choice. I said in my prayer earlier that God gave us the freedom to make our own choices, and that's a reason to thank him. But what if he was to take away that freedom? Are we ready for that? Would we be diminished in some way? Would we lose something? I think we probably would. When I was wee, I remember getting too close to the coal fire we had in our living room. I'd been told not to, of course. And the fire sputtered and a spark landed on my arm, giving me a nasty wee burn. My mum's reaction was to put butter on it. I remember thinking that was pretty weird at the time. Does anybody else do that, put butter on it? But it definitely soothed the pain. My dad's reaction, that'll learn you, he said. That'll teach you. Sometimes we learn more from what we do wrong than what we do right. Anyway, Joseph doesn't condemn his brothers for the evil they've done, because he's not in the place of God. Everything that's gone before and that will come after is part of God's plan. And that's something Joseph is quick to recognize, God's plan. But that's another tough one to think about, isn't it? How many times have we heard someone say it must have been God's plan when something bad or tragic comes about? I'm not too sure about that. I think it's a bit shallow, and I think we could drive ourselves crazy trying to see the purpose of God in everything that happens. The verse from Jeremiah I mentioned at the start of our service today tells us, I alone know the plans I have for you. I alone. It's not for us to discern God's plan or try to second guess what he's got in store for us. His will be done. And his will was done in this instance, because it's only when we look back at things that we can see God's plan in action. Looking back from where we stand now, we can see how God's plan played out in the story of Joseph. If he hadn't been mistreated by his brothers, he wouldn't have ended up in Egypt. If he hadn't ended up in jail in Egypt, he'd never have come to the attention of Pharaoh. And if Pharaoh had never known him, Joseph would never have saved Egypt from famine. You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. See, bad things happened to Joseph, but good came out of it. And God's plan was that through him, many people should be kept alive. And it was also God's plan, if we look even further back, that these people would be kept alive because he'd promised to Jacob's great-grandfather Abraham that he'd be the father of a multitude of nations. As I say, when we look back, we can see God's plan, and we can see the proof that God keeps his promises. So did the brothers eventually receive their just deserts? Again, the words that I like so much come up in the story. Do not fear, says Joseph. I'll provide for you and your little ones. After all that's happened to him, he comforts his brothers. He speaks kindly to them, telling them he's going to take care of them and their families. Is that what they deserve? Doing evil deserves punishment, doesn't it? Doing wrong means retribution. Sentencing follows sin. Not for Simeon and Levi and Reuben and the rest of the brothers, because they have a forgiving brother, a brother who rejects revenge, who refuses to show resentment, a brother who just won't bear the grudge, a brother who, even though he suffered, gave his suffering for the benefit of the greater good. Does that remind you of anyone? The parallels between Joseph and Jesus are hard to ignore. Both took care of their father's sheep. Both were betrayed. Both were sold for silver. Both were falsely accused and imprisoned. I could go on. It would take too long to go through all the parallels just now, but you can look up whole lists of comparisons, and I'm happy to point you towards a few later if you get in touch. But for me, all these pale into insignificance compared to the readiness, the willingness of both of them to forgive. Joseph forgave. Jesus forgives. All the evil, all the transgression, all the impediments that we think might get in our way or stand against us in our hope that one day we might enter the kingdom of God, well, they can be put aside if, like Joseph's brothers, we only come clean, come forward, and ask for that forgiveness. And we have a God who, through Jesus and his suffering, is willing and ready and able to forgive. So I guess my question to you today is, are we all ready to ask for our just desserts? I think we should be, because as I said a while back, forgiveness, lasting reconciliation, well, I think they're the sweetest dessert of all. Amen. Now, our next piece of music isn't a hymn, but for me at least, I'd be quite happy to see it in a hymn book. I think it's just human nature that when things don't go our way, we turn to God and ask him what we have done to deserve it. But I'm not sure that we turn to him often enough to ask the same question when things do go our way. This song is Why Me, Lord?
So Jesus, my soul's in your hand.
There's a really good clip online where Chris Christopherson tells the story of how he came to write Why Me, Lord. He speaks of being given a forgiveness that he didn't even know he needed. And I think it's a really powerful message. It's worth looking up if you have time. For now, though, let's come to God in prayer again. Let us pray. Lord, so often we come to you asking why. Why me, Lord? But why everyone else too? Why in a world that you created to be good is there still so much suffering and pain? It serves us well to remind ourselves, though, that the suffering and pain of the world isn't of your doing, it's our work. It's the work of mankind. And that the world we live in, all of its faults and failings, is the price we pay for the freedom you gave us to choose the paths we take. We remind ourselves that when we feel helpless, you're always there for us to reach out to for comfort, for solace, for support. So in a moment of silence, we reach out to you now. We reach out to you now, offering our prayers for ourselves and for those close to us. We're still suffering through restrictions placed upon us by the COVID crisis. And while the pandemic isn't exactly the work of man, how we deal with it surely is. So today we bring our prayers to you for those who are working so hard to make it something of the past, not the present. We give thanks and prayers for those who have produced the vaccine and prayers for protection for those responsible for administering it. And we ask you to console and be with those who have been most affected, those who have fallen ill, or who have lost friends or family members. We ask you to be the guiding hand behind those in positions of responsibility, those who make the laws of the land we have to live by to keep us safe. Please, Lord, give them the wisdom to do what is right and the compassion to keep the people's best interests at heart. Political unrest and insurrection are certainly the work of mankind. And as we look to places like Myanmar, which are going through such turbulent times, we ask that you would protect the innocent people caught up in or displaced by the conflict, the refugees living in cramped camps who can't go home. We ask that you would offer them hope for the future. Father, when we ask why there is so much pain and suffering, it's, well, maybe we're asking the wrong question. Maybe we should be more preoccupied by what we can do about it. Well, there are plenty of examples of people who daily do good things and who help to make our world a better place. So we give thanks and offer prayers for them. We give thanks and prayers for those who work for the greater good of our community and beyond, the teachers who take care of the children of essential workers, the parents who provide homeschooling, the shop workers, the care home workers, the worship leaders like our own Steve Hay, all people who continue to serve those who need the stability of knowing that all hasn't come to a stop during these difficult times. We pray that you would give them the strength to keep on keeping on, and give them the comfort of knowing that their work is so much appreciated. Father, we bring our prayers to you in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So we come now to our final hymn for today, and it is a hymn this time. This is Mission Praise 200, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is his faithfulness. So thank you for joining me this week. Steve will be back again with you next Sunday, and hopefully, God willing, I'll see you all again soon. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and always. Amen.